Welcome to the Valley College Connection, where John Kawai and Scott Wigand, two Valley professors, engage in a conversation about success with educators and students. Each week, they'll sit down with a different guest to find out ways each of us have had to plan, persevere, and overcome to where we are now. The show will also highlight resources and services that are working to make a difference at Valley College.
We are joined today by Dr. Eric Maseko, Associate Professor of Reading at Los Angeles Valley College. Thank you so much for joining us today, Eric.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
We wanted to hear your story and journey that led you to Valley College. So please take us back, go as far back as you'd like to, and let us know the steps along the way that brought you here.
For me, one thing that got me to Valley College that was a very important motivation was I'm a first-generation college student. And I went to a community college. That was my first contact with college. My sister is also a first-generation college student. She's older than me, and she had gone to a four-year school. When I was in high school, I didn't really have much of a plan, and my parents didn't really have much of a plan in terms of me going to college. I had no plan at the end when I graduated high school, and I went to a community college in Orlando, Florida, Valencia Community College. Now it's called Valencia College. And it was just such a life-changing experience for me in a positive way. I had kind of gotten, I'd always been interested in learning and like new things, but I'd kind of gotten off of track with learning at school when I was in high school. It was at that college, in my community college experience, that I really rediscovered the joy of learning. And I kind of found my way. After I went through, you know, different things I've done in my life, especially in my PhD program, which I'll fill in the gaps up to there in a minute, I really made a conscious decision that I would like at some point in my life to be able to teach at a community college and give back in a way that, you know, in the same way that I'd gotten so much to my own community college experience.
So, Eric, let me rewind you a little bit. Were you a good student in elementary school?
So I was actually one of the first two kids in the Orange County, Florida, Orange County Public School System gifted program. I was a very smart little kid, and I loved school. I did very well in school up until high school. High school was not easy for me. I had a lot of problems at home. Our family had moved. And I, as I said earlier, I kind of lost interest in learning and, you know, things to do with school. But prior to about 10th grade, I was a very good student in school. And in 10th grade, I kind of lost my way, and I didn't really, I didn't do well in one of my math classes. I didn't know how to ask for help, and the help that I received wasn't really helping. I didn't realize I could have or should have been more proactive to seek out the help I needed. And so I just went into an academic downward spiral from that point on through the end of high school. By the time I got to my senior year, I kind of bluffed my way through my classes. I learned how to cheat really well. I think that's why I've always been a good teacher, because if a kid's going to cheat, I know exactly what they're going to do, because I probably did it myself. I was always very interested in school, and I did very well in school up until that point. So going to a community college, it was really reinvigorating for my soul and in terms of intellectual pursuits as well.
So Eric, when you got to Valencia College, which now Valencia, you know, for the last decade or so is always heralded as this top community college in the nation and winner of the Athens Institute Award, and school that you had a chance to go there back when you started off. I'm sure a lot has changed, but for you and your experience there, what was a pivotal or transitional moment at the community college? Was it a particular instructor or class, or what sort of rekindled the desire for learning within the academic context?
That's a good question, and I've often asked myself that same question. Like what inspired me, and what should I do as an instructor for my students if I can connect in that way? And I think some of the big things for me were, class sizes weren't too large. I'd say there were 20 to 30 students in a class in most cases, sometimes a little smaller. I really felt like all of my professors, not just one, but all of them, were very connected with all of the students. And especially in my case, it was very important that I had professors who knew my name and tried to make an effort to get to know me and other students and find out what our strengths and weaknesses were. And they were there. Like when we needed help, in my case, I needed help, I could go to their office during office hours and I could ask questions. And I was very scared at first. They made me feel very comfortable with learning. I think that was very important. And it also felt like the campus community of other students, being able to see people from so many different backgrounds and different age ranges, for example, was really inspiring to me to see people, because I was, 18 years old, see people in their 50s, 60s, even 70s back at school. I was like, wow, that is so cool. And I enjoyed hearing stories from people who had more life experience than me or different life experience. And it was that kind of diversity really was a big thing for me as well. Getting to know other people, not just my professors, but, you know, the other students and people on campus. It was a very welcoming place.
So when you walked onto campus, what was your intention? Did you have a major in mind or a career path that you were thinking about?
I had no idea. When I was in high school, I actually had a very good English teacher. I was in the gifted English program in high school, and he tried to get all the students that he taught ready for college. You know, in those days, take the SAT, apply for scholarship money. I got very different messages at home. I wasn't really encouraged to go to college, and I didn't get a lot of support. And I actually got some animosity often from my father about going to college. So I didn't really take advantage of that opportunity. So when I went into community college, I had no idea in mind what I wanted to do, because my father kept saying, you need to join the army, or you need to, like, one time I had found an ad for a locksmith, like, be a locksmith on your own, like in the Farmer's Almanac or something. He's like, I thought you were going to become a locksmith. So I had no idea. And I think answering Scott's question, I think this is part of it, is the ability to discover what I wanted to do, like to have that space where I could move at a comfortable pace, was also a very important part of my community college experience for me, because it was there that I realized I love language. I took lots of English classes, creative writing, poetry, literature, and I studied Spanish. And I realized, wow, this is, I really love learning other languages. And my mother is originally from Holland via Germany. And so her family had emigrated from Germany to Holland after World War II. Her mother was Dutch, so they were able to move to Holland. I spent a good chunk of my early years actually living in Holland. It was very normal to my uncles and my relatives to speak many languages. I always had a fascination with language, I think, because of that. And so being able to study other languages at community college, like, I was able to find my way into things that I enjoyed. I realized that was the direction I wanted to go. I took business classes, and I realized that just wasn't the right fit for me. Being able to find what was a good fit for me, I think that was very integral for me, to like have that space to discover what I enjoyed.
You know, I find every semester that I have one or two students who have shared with me the same kind of, I guess, frustration they have at home, mm-hmm. with a parent, usually it's a father, mm-hmm. who is frustrated with the amount of college they're doing. I just had a conversation with a student just last week, so it's been forefront on my mind. Mm-hmm. How did that ever resolve for you, or has it ever resolved in terms of your choosing this academic path?
That's a whole nother conversation in a podcast, John. I'd say the short answer is no, it never really resolved. and I would say I don't care, because I love the path that I followed. It wasn't the path that I would have thought about following myself. You know, I mean, as I said, I had no preconceived notion. I wanted to play rock music and, you know, be in a band. I played music at different points in my life. I've ended up mainly in academia and teaching. I got my AA, and then I transferred to Florida State University. Actually, I transferred to the University of Central Florida, which in those days was, you know, it's UCF. It was known as You Can't Finish among a lot of students, you know, like me, because a lot of students, local kids like me, had transferred with an AA. Like, you know, by law, we had to be admitted into the school. But the problem was there were so many other students ahead of me who had transferred in from Valencia Community College or other schools that there was a waiting list. So I was accepted, and I had a double major of English and Spanish, but I could only get one or two classes a semester because there was a waiting list of people who were ahead of me. I was getting one or two classes a semester, and I wasn't, it was going to take 6 or 7 years to finish, it looked like. So I found a way to transfer to Florida State University in Tallahassee. And what really excited me there is they had a Japanese program. And it was at that time, I don't know if Florida State had a Japanese program, but it was either Florida State or the University of Florida. So it was either going to be Florida State or the University of Florida. I went to FSU and I studied Japanese. I ended up finding a job with the Japanese government teaching English as a second language in a Japanese junior high school right out of undergrad. And that's where the next part of my story kind of picks up. It's how I kind of went into an academic career path.
As you went to these different colleges, were there any professors in particular that stood out, and why?
The professors in my major, I felt very close to many of them because they had shared their life experience with me. And some of them, they would say, well, I don't know if this is pedagogically the right way to explain it, but this really worked for me. So why don't you try this and see if it worked for you? And I thought that was a great way to approach teaching, because they kind of gave us the option of, well, you can try this, and if it fits your learning style or who you are, that's fantastic. If it doesn't, try something else. But this is what I did, and it worked for me. Those were professors I felt very close to, the people I could talk to. They talked to me like people. I felt like they were weren't talking to me as a you know, someone in a superior position down to a subordinate, but someone who looked at me, they looked at me and other students as future colleagues, if that makes sense, you know, or peers. And I really appreciated that level of respect.
Eric, why Japanese? Was there a particular experience or affinity for it prior to transferring there and knowing that they had a program?
Well, I'd like to say that I had lofty ambitions, but it was the early 90s. At that time, the Japanese economy was the second strongest in the world, you know, after the US. There were many people, other students I knew who said, wow, if you learn Japanese and go to Japan, you'll make a lot of money. And so I said I had no guidance, you know, at home or, you know, from most other sources. So I thought, well, I'll learn Japanese and I'll study business and go make a lot of money. And I had no idea what any of that entailed. That's one reason. And if I'm really being honest, I was always fascinated by Japanese because my sister, and she's 7 years older than me, when she went to college, she left me her record collection. And she had a lot of records that were, they were American bands, but they were albums that had been pressed in Japan. So all of the cover and like liner notes, they were all in Japanese. There was, you know, a band called Cheap Trick. Mm-hmm. And she had won all of their albums up to that point, like in 1982. And she had their legendary Live at Budokan album. And everything inside was in Japanese. And I thought, you know, and I knew different bands that I liked had played in Japan. I was like, wow, that would be so cool if one day I could read this, you know, I could actually play music in Japan. And that was actually... I mean, something that really interested me way more than the idea of like doing business or, you know, anything else. But I was fascinated by the script, the writing system in Japanese. Like I said, in community college, that's where I discovered that I really loved languages and I had a bit of a knack for it. So when I got to Florida State, it was great to meet other people who had similar interests. Yeah. And then I got it. That's how I ended up in Japan. And the Japanese government has it's still in existence. It's a program where they hire usually, college graduates who are just fresh out of college, and they teach in a Japanese junior high or high school for 1 to 3 years.
Was it the JET program?
The JET program, it was, yeah, the Japan Exchange Teaching Program.
Oh, they must have been so happy. When my friends go, they're all so disappointed because the students are like, oh, great, we're going to learn English from another Asian person. Whenever they get like a white teacher, they're like, yeah, this feels like real English. But whenever my friends go, they go like, I got someone like you like right over here. Like, I wanted real English.
That is something that I did encounter in Japan. And I lived in Japan for about 6 years. And then I lived in Taiwan for about 9 years after that. I did encounter that some Japanese people did not want to learn English from someone who they did not perceive to be a native speaker of English because of the color of their skin or the way they looked. And I encountered the same thing in Taiwan, where some people didn't want to learn English from, you know, someone who looked Asian. You can never tell what language a person speaks by looking at them.
Sure.
And that's what I would always tell my students. I was like, don't, you know, you have no idea. So if someone's your teacher, just listen to them. And they have something to teach you, I'm sure.
Well, I want to hear about Japan. But before we get there, I got to know, 90s Florida State, how are the football games?
John, I may be one of only like three people who've ever graduated from Florida State who doesn't watch football.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I've never gotten into football.
You were in the football mecca in the moment at the time, and
I would be in my apartment. The town and the campus would be empty, literally. Think of my whole time at Florida State. I went to one game. Yeah, and I used to love the campus during games because it was so quiet. It was like it was like the end of the world, and I was the last person in the world. It was very calming, and then every now and then you'd hear this loud roar from the crowd. And then, you know, except for that, it was, you couldn't hear anything.
I'm Japanese. So I had a lot of friends who did the Japanese language route.
Uh-huh.
And the people who did really well were the people who paired it with one other skill.
Uh-huh.
So my uncle, he did Japanese, but he also did international banking. And he did really well. My brother-in-law did graphic design.
Uh-huh.
In Japanese. But I think the people who just did Japanese, it was a hard career path because they didn't really need translators.
Yeah. And that's one thing that I learned early on after I got to Japan and then, you know, in Taiwan, is that I heard voices of other people in my head saying, oh, just learn Japanese, go to Japan, you'll make a lot of money. It never occurred to me that there's millions and millions of Japanese people who are perfectly bilingual in English and Japanese.
They teach English in the schools.
Yes.
Everyone in Japan learns English and Japanese. So the one skill you didn't need was Japanese and English. Although I think the thing that was, this was back when Japan was flush in money. The way to make money was work for an American company in Japan.
I heard that too. And that's why I was thinking I would do something like that.
So how was the JET program?
Oh, I really enjoyed the JET program. I had a very unusual job for the JET program. Most jobs in those days, and I think even today on the JET program, most people that get hired to teach generally get assigned to a public school or a public school board. I actually got assigned to a private, at the time, private boys school. It was a junior high and high school, one building. You know, when you get hired for the JET program, at least in those days, they ask you to list three preferences where you'd like to be sent. You know, I didn't know many people in Japan. So I said, well, I know someone in Tokyo. I'll say Tokyo. I know someone in Osaka. And I know someone in Sendai up in the north, you know, on the eastern seaboard. And they sent me to Ibaraki, which is none of the above. I was in a town called Mito, which is the capital of Ibaraki Prefecture, which is about, I don't know, about 75 miles directly north on the eastern side of Japan from Tokyo. There was a tsunami that in the nuclear reactor incident, unfortunately, in Fukushima Prefecture. Ibaraki is the prefecture directly south of there. So unfortunately, actually, when that happened, I knew a lot of people that were affected because actually a lot of the kids that I taught, they would commute in from Fukushima. That was really unfortunate. I didn't know anyone directly who was hurt or killed, but a lot of people I know were displaced or they had to deal with a lot of problems because of that. Yeah, I ended up in Ibaraki and Mito though, and it was a fantastic experience. In Japan, you know, Ibaraki is called the countryside, but I had never seen that much concrete before in my life. It was a fantastic experience because I learned a lot about, not just about Japan, but you know, I grew up in Orlando, Florida, mainly from kindergarten forward. I had never really lived in a cold climate. So like a lot of things that I thought were unique to Japan, I didn't realize were just simply common in cold climates. Like, I'm like, look at these gloves. You put them on before you put your gloves on to keep your hands warm. And like all my, you know, the people I met from England and, you know, Michigan, Washington, they're like, no, we have that where we live too, because it's cold. I'm like, oh, okay.
Well, I feel like you lucked out. Like when you're listing them, I was thinking, oh, I hope they gave you the countryside because the people are just nicer in the countryside.
Yeah, I met a lot of great people. It was really interesting because I think that English education is part of the curriculum in Japanese junior high schools and high school. And I kind of equate English education in Japan to like Spanish as a second, you know, as a foreign language that people study in the U.S. Like a lot of people who aren't native speakers of Spanish would say, well, I'll study Spanish in high school and take 2 years in college. But these people can read, you know, or speak a few words. But if they don't use it, they don't really, yeah, you know, they can't speak too fluently. And I think a lot of Japanese people are the same way with English.
Yeah, you can communicate if you write. Yeah. So if you're ever in Japan, you travel, just keep a pad of paper with you and just write.
Right.
My problem is that my Japanese is broken. Mm-hmm. So they'll look at me like a native. Mm-hmm. And then when I speak, my Japanese is terrible. Or I'll have to ask someone, could you read that for me? I can't read. Mm-hmm. And they'll look at me like, oh, you poor man. So like little kids will run away from me because I'm like, what is that saying?
Oh, I see, yeah.
Right? Because they just expect me to be able to read. But I'll have old ladies hold my hand, go, let me take you to your train.
Well, and that was my experience in the countryside was I would meet people, especially older Japanese people who at that time, like in the mid-90s, they would have been in their 80s or 90s. And they hadn't gone through English education in the school system, and they really spoke no English. Those people were awesome because they would talk to me, and there was no pretense about being worried about forgetting the English they learned in school or trying to practice English. They didn't know any English. It was great to meet, like you said, you know, people from the countryside and just to have conversations. And most people were just so delighted to meet someone who they perceived as not being Japanese, who spoke some Japanese. And I really enjoy that. And coming back to what you said, I had a good friend, his parents, I met him on the JET program. He was from Richmond, Virginia. His parents were from China. So he was Asian. I would hang out with him on the weekends. Sometimes he'd come to my city, you know, to go shopping because he literally lived in the rice, among the rice fields in the countryside. We'd go shopping and a lot of Japanese people would look at him and start talking to him. He spoke no Japanese. And then I would speak Japanese, but they would turn in to him again because, you know, I'm white and he's Asian. It was very interesting for me to see how people are often cued by what they see and what they perceive. I had the same bias. I thought, well, a lot of Japanese people, you know, they don't really speak English, you know, whatever. And, you know, I never like said bad things about anyone in English in front of other Japanese people. But one time I went to a friend of mine, he's also from the United States. He's from Virginia as well. He lived in a small town. We went to a bookstore and we took the bus and, you know, through the rice fields, we went to a bookstore and we went to buy some books. We went to the counter. The person behind the counter didn't say anything. She just looked at us and she went back through the curtains. And then this gentleman came out and he could have been 90 years old. And he looked at us and he pulled his glasses down and he said, say, you from the States? Where are you from in the States? You know, and I had to admit that I had this bias or this idea that I wouldn't have expected that in that, especially in that little town, that this guy would come out. He's clearly a native speaker of English. And I mean, obviously a balanced bilingual because he spoke Japanese as well. And I learned that day, you never judge a book by its cover, because, you know, I would always tell my students, I taught ESL for many years, and say, if you speak a language or any language you speak, you should assume that everyone else around you speak that language, because be careful what you say, because people, there's always someone who will understand.
Were you in the JET program for the full 6 years?
No. So I was in the JET program for 3 years. This was right before the internet. So I arrived in 1994 and I was on my job through 1997. So it was right during the time when the internet really started taking hold. I used old school dictionaries. You know, someone had told me if you could read a Japanese newspaper, your Japanese is really good. But what does that mean? I had no idea what that meant. Every day I would photocopy a news article and I'd painstakingly look up every word in my dictionaries. And I would translate the articles. And then after a while, I got pretty good at it. My colleagues, they would speak Japanese with. One day, I worked in the English department, and one of the English teachers there, she said, my German professor in college at Ibaraki University down the street, he now teaches, I guess you call it like a Japanese affairs class, you know, Japan Today kind of class. A lot of the international students from the university attend the class along with Japanese students, but there aren't any Western students in the class. And one of the points of the class is to hear different cultural perspectives about Japan. Would you be interested in going to this class? And I said, I would, but I don't know if I can read well enough or if my Japanese is good enough. She's like, no, that should be fine. And so she talked to the English department chair and he said, that's a fantastic idea. And he talked to the principal and the principal said, if Eric can keep improving his Japanese, that will really help the school because then he can communicate with the students better and their parents and it's good for the school. So on Wednesdays, you're just going to teach one class in the morning and then the rest of the day is all yours. Just go to the university and sit in this class. So I sat in on that class for a year and I could barely, you know, I would listen, I could understand. And it was very frustrating because I couldn't really speak. And all the other students would read the articles, you know, or, you know, whatever. And I was struggling. I did that for a year and I was able to keep up. And then one day I spoke, you know, and then it didn't stop. And I met my ex-wife in that class. So she's from Taiwan originally, and she was getting her bachelor's in education, and then she went on to get her master's in education. We met there, and through knowing her, I entered my master's program in education at Ibaraki University. So in my third year of the JET program, I knew that I was going to take the entrance exam for my program, my master's program. And so,
in Japanese?
Yes, everything was in Japanese.
Wow.
And I had the blessing of my school behind me. They actually wanted me to stay longer, but they said, yeah, it's a great opportunity. You should do it. And so I was a grad student in Japan for 2 years.
Just so people understand what Eric is talking about, in order to read a newspaper, it takes 16,000 characters to read a Japanese newspaper. So if you start thinking about how do I, and it's hieroglyphics, right? It's not letters. It's 16,000 unique characters. And then you start saying, well, what if I learn 10 a day and then don't forget any I learned before? That's still 5 years before you can read a newspaper. So for you to be able to do it in that short term is incredible. I have a friend who took the Japanese entrance exam. Mm-hmm. And was given a similar type of scholarship to Shizuoka University. I know what it takes to do that. I have an aunt who lived in Japan for 20 years. She has a master's in Japanese literacy.
Mm-hmm.
And she told me, I can't read a newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And so she actually sat down and explained the math to me. Like, if you're going to be someone who can work in business over here and read a newspaper, this is what it takes. So she actually broke down the math to me. So whenever people come up to me and go, oh, yeah, I'm just going to learn Mandarin because I'll just get a job in China. I'm like, it's the same alphabet, right? I explain the math to them. Like, just so you know, there are probably easier ways to create a career than to learn Mandarin or Japanese.
Well, it's interesting, you know, you bring up Mandarin because I got my master's degree and everything was in Japanese. A lot of Japanese graduate programs don't have the same rigor that certain American master's programs might have, but they're rigorous in other ways. So it's like it's a trade-off in different areas, but it was a real struggle for me. And I think one of the biggest things that I took away from that is my mother's an immigrant. She's been an immigrant many times. She's born in Germany, went to Holland, and then she came to the U.S. And my mom actually became a U.S. citizen on my first birthday. I've always had some sense of what it's like to people come to the United States who have to learn English. And just the different things they have to go through. But having been a student in Japan, and again, I'm not trying to equate what I went through as a white American man in Japan to like the hardships that many people face coming to the US, because it's not quite the same in many cases, but just having to deal with the constant hassles of a visa, constantly feeling like I'm not good enough because I don't know enough Japanese, or having to spend hours trying to figure out how to read an article so that I can get my work done. It gave me such a great appreciation of how amazing people are who come to the US. It's often taken for granted that, well, everyone just speaks English or learns English, but that is not the case. You know, I try to advocate for everyone who learns English as a second language in the US, because I think they're amazing, because I don't know if I always felt like I succeeded compared to other English speaking Americans who've been in Japan. Yeah, my Japanese is pretty good, but I've always felt like I could have learned more or done more. But you're right, though, about the script. The kanji in Japanese, the Chinese characters, are also used in Mandarin. In mainland China, they use simplified characters. But I went to Taiwan, where traditional characters are still used, and they're closer in form to the kanji in Japanese. So when I first arrived in Taiwan, I knew I was going to move to Taiwan. Like, I talked to my ex-wife and I said, you know, she finished her master's a year before me. I said, do you want to go to Taiwan? She's like, yeah. I said, I would love to go to Taiwan. Because we had traveled, you know, visited many times. And so I started learning Mandarin like a year before we went, like the last year of my master's program. When I got to Taiwan, it was very weird, because I could read 85% of anything. I could tell where the bathroom was, and I could tell where the train station was and whatnot, but I had no grammar. Japanese is unique in that it uses three scripts. You have the Chinese characters, you know, 75 to 80% of those are used in sentences for content words, you know, nouns, ideas. And then the hiragana, which performs a grammatical function. It makes a word an adjective or a verb or whatever you can tell. And then there's the katakana. It's often used to transliterate words that are not from Japanese or Chinese originally. It's like McDonald's would be makuru narudo. And so, and I'm Eric, so I'm Eriku. Katakana would be used to write that. Where the katakana and hiragana were used in Japan to connect the kanji, there were Chinese characters in Mandarin, and that would just throw me off. And so I had to figure out what the grammatical markers were in Chinese. But by then, I didn't have to learn the characters from scratch. I knew them. I just needed to figure out the sound correspondence. Like, if this character is pronounced this way in Japanese, it's almost always pronounced this way in Mandarin. And I figured out pretty quickly how to figure out the pronunciations. The tones were challenging for me. But yeah, I was unusual in being a native English speaker to have that background going into Mandarin first. I forgot what we were talking about. I'm sorry.
Let me ask this. How did you end up at Valley College then? It sounds like you're like James Bond, just going from like country to country, just learning language after language.
No. Hold on one sec.
Before we go there, I gotta hear it. Let's wrap up a little bit more about your experience there in Taiwan. So how long were you there for? You said, was that for 6 years?
I was in Japan for 6 years. I worked for 3 years in the JET program I taught at a high school. And then I took my entrance exam and I was my master's for 2 years. And then I moved to Taiwan. So I was 6 years in Japan and Taiwan for about 9 years, 8.5 years. Yeah. And so, for most of my time in Taiwan, I worked at the Taipei World Trade Center, and I taught English for specific purposes. And I worked for a government-run international trade training program. And so I mainly worked with people who had MBAs, and they spoke great English, but they needed to go to the next level, you know, because international trade really drives Taiwan's economy. And most of these people worked in the IT industry. IT is the lifeblood of Taiwan. And, you know, some of the biggest IT trade shows in the world are at the Taipei World Trade Center. I didn't know any of this. And, you know, I learned along the way. I taught English for specific purposes, like business English. And so my business minor in college came in handy, because I was able to get this job. And so I taught ESL part time. And then one day someone upstairs called and I answered the phone and I said, "Wei, 培训中心你好." And they started talking to me and they said, "Oh yeah, can you send one of the teachers up to look at an English document to edit it?" I said, "No, I'll go do it myself." And they said, no, we want one of the English teachers." I said, "I am one of the English teachers." They're like, "You speak Mandarin?" It's like, "Well, I speak a little." And they're like, "Can you read?" I'm like, "Yeah." And so they gave me a job in the market development department. And so I would teach in the mornings, and then a few days a week, I'd go up to the seventh floor in the market development department. I worked with a team. I did editing, English editing. I did writing. I wrote copy. I did all kinds of things. And I got to work with, and the market development department was this huge room with rows of desks each row was a different section. There was like the West Asia section, the East Asia section, you know, South Africa, North, you know, Africa. And so all of these people could speak the languages, or they had to, because they had traveled to all of these countries or had been assigned, posted there. And so I worked with these in a room full of Taiwanese people who were just, they were multilingual, and they'd been all around the world. I mean, brilliant people. And, you know, they all spoke, you know, Mandarin, English, and so many languages. And what's really funny is I actually at that time had the strongest Japanese of the few people that spoke Japanese. So sometimes when they had, you know, Japanese, you know, groups come for whatever reason, they would bring me in to do interpreting or to translate documents, because a lot of the Taiwanese people could speak English, you know, very well, or they were bilingual, but not many could really speak Japanese very well. And there was always someone on the Japanese side that spoke English, but not Mandarin. So I was in between. And so it was just such an unusual space to be in, to be that white guy from America in his 30s, being the go-between between these two different groups of people, mainly Taiwanese and Japanese. And I thought that was so cool. And I, you know, and I worked with other people who did the same thing. There was a woman I worked with, she had lived in Holland and she spoke Dutch. I mean, and of course, you know, the Dutch business people that came all spoke English, but they loved having her there because it was just nice to connect with someone who spoke their language fluently. And it was just such a neat place.
Sounds like an incredible experience, Eric.
It was.
As you were telling us, you know, at the beginning of this, one of the reasons that initially sort of got you interested in Japanese was music and your sister's record collection. For the time that you were in Japan and Taiwan, was there any circle back to music at all for you?
Yes. So in Japan, so most school high schools in Japan will have like a school festival day. And I don't know how it is now with COVID, but you know, there's like a day or a weekend where, you know, the different clubs that the kids belong to will put on, they'll have like a stall or a booth and do something fun. So like the chess club might have a chess board and, you know, people sit down and play games. You know, there might be like the chorus and people sing songs, whatever. And there's always like 20 different rock bands. And so I started playing guitar when I was 15. And like I said, my ambition early on was to be a rock guitarist. You know, I listening to my Huey Lewis records in the early 80s, and you know, and I got the songbook and I had a guitar. And so I heard, this is really interesting. One day I was staying late, and you know, everyone had gone, and it was at night, and I heard Lynyrd Skynyrd coming from the high school. And I was like, this, you know, I grew up in, you know, Florida, you know, there's a lot of Southern rock, but I never expected to hear it in Japan. And I'm like, what is this? I heard these guys singing, and I go, and then there's the Allman Brothers. Then I hear all this kind of like, you know, Southern rock and things, you know, and I go into this classroom, and it's like five of the high school kids, and they're in a band, and they were really tight, and they loved to play blues. The one kid had a harmonica. And so they weren't my students. I taught mainly the junior high school, but I started talking to them, and the one kid had a really cool Les Paul guitar. And I said, you mind if I give it a try? I've never played one. And so we started jamming, and I would bring my guitar, and we'd hang out on the weekends and go to like a practice studio. And what's beautiful about Japan is, and in Taiwan, the same thing. There's a lot of studios, like where there's already like the drums, keyboards, amps, everything's set up. You just bring your own guitar. And, you know, the microphones are all set up, and there's a mixer, and you pay like $10, $20 an hour just to jam, you know, with your band. And so I would hang out with these kids on the weekends, like not just that group of kids, but other kids. And so every school festival, I would be playing with like five or six different bands, because most of the kids couldn't play the lead guitar parts. And I could, because I had more experience. So they would always hire me as their, you know, lead guitarist for the day. And so I did that. And when I lived in Taiwan, I ended up playing music as well. At one point, I pared my day job down just to my teaching. In the afternoons and evenings, I played in several bands. I worked in a recording studio. So if you hear some bad pop music from around 2002, 2003 from Taiwan, it may be my guitar. And I played with different bands. And I met this guy, and he said, we should play all the big shows, all the big venues in Taiwan. And I'm like, how are we going to do that? He's like, oh, no, we'll figure that out. And he did. He said, well, we'll send press release. And he did. He showed me how to do it. And we went around and played all the big venues on the island. And I got to meet a lot of Taiwanese musicians. Like, celebrity isn't quite the same in Taiwan as it is in the U.S. And I met some really, you know, well-known, not just Taiwanese, but Mandarin pop stars, or like a lot of people from Hong Kong, you know, who came to the studio where I worked. And it was just amazing to be able to like sit in and jam with these people on the guitar, you know, to the bass or whatever, you know. So I did that off and on. And music has always been a big part of my life. And at Valley College, one of my colleagues in the psychology department, he's retired now, Harry Fink, you know, he's been playing music locally in Southern California for years. And he plays in a blues band, the Bulldog Blues Band. And we were talking, he has a guitar in his office, I had a guitar in my office. And then one day I said, you know, I live in Long Beach. He said, well, we're going to be playing Long Beach. Why don't you come in and sit in with us? I said, you know, you've never heard me play, Harry. He goes, I'm sure you're fine. And so I brought my guitar down to the marina, and they were set up outdoors. And, you know, they all wear fedoras in that band, you know, like the Blues Brothers, I guess. And I remember plugging my guitar, and I was like, so I'm just going to sit in for the one number. And then I hear the drummer, a 1, 2, 3. And then it was a whole set. So I'm very thankful to Harry, because I've been able to jam with their band on and off a few times in the last few years. And I hadn't played live music for years, because after I came back to the U.S., I came back to the U.S. to get my PhD, and then pretty much everything in life except the PhD kind of stopped. So it was great to be able to play music again.
Wow, man, it's an incredible experience and story. It sounds as though how your life sort of unfolded there in Japan and Taiwan. So you left there and then you came back for your PhD. Where did you go to school?
So I think John had asked a question about this earlier, and I said, I'll answer that. And then I talked about 20 other things. After I was in Taiwan for a few years, I loved my life in Taiwan. I got to teach, which I loved. And I didn't talk about that, but, one thing in my first job, and I'm going to answer your question, Scott, I promise. But I remember you asked me what, you know, did I have a plan? I never really had a plan. And for me, going to Japan to teach English as a second language at a junior high school, that was not my plan. That was like a stepping stone in my mind to learn Japanese and become fluent and then do something really great. I mean, that's where I was at that time. I was 23 years old. But I remember my very first day in the summer, there was no one there, and I was in the English department, and one teacher came in, and he's like, here's the textbook and here's the stick, like a pointer, you know, to point to the board. And he's like, "Onegai shimasu." And then he left. And I'm like, what? I'm like, what do I teach? He's like, well, here's the textbook and then here's your pointer stick. And I'm like, and I had no training in anything. And again, I feel very fortunate that I was in an environment where I was able to make some mistakes and nobody held it against me. I mean, I was doing my best, but I had to learn a lot on the job, you know, as I went along. But I remember like my first day of class in Japan was 43 boys. They all had short cropped black hair and they had black uniforms, and I couldn't really read any Japanese. And I walked in and it was just dead silence and no one said anything. But I remember like I wasn't really nervous, and you know, the boys would change seats because everyone has an assigned seat, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, and they would switch because like he doesn't speak Japanese, you know, we'll fool him. And so I stayed home that night, you know, I stayed up that night and I learned all of their names in Japanese. Like I knew what they were doing, but I didn't have the skills to like call them out on it. So the next day I said, you know, I'd be like, ah, Shimizu-kun. And then the one kid would giggle over here, but he should be in this seat here. So they had the seating chart. I knew who they were. And so when they realized that I knew what they were doing, they got really scared because they thought I was gonna tell the school disciplinarian. And I didn't. So I just kind of hassled them back, and you know, and they were wonderful. And I remember like early on that first week, I thought this is fun. And I never felt like I didn't know what I was doing, or that I didn't, that I wasn't doing something to help them. Cause you know, beyond that, I figured out how to, you know, teach them some English, you know, what I was supposed to do. And it didn't feel unnatural. It always felt like breathing. And I think I took that for granted for many years. What I'm saying is that I realized that I love to teach. I think from that job, I realized that I love that. So when I was in Taiwan, I had taught for many years, and I thought, you know, and this touched on what you were saying, John, too, really, is that I'd spent all of this time, you know, in Japan trying to figure out how to read, speak, and write Japanese. And since that wasn't enough, I went to Taiwan and did the same thing all over with Mandarin. And I thought there's got to be an easier way to do this. And I started reading academic journal articles about how to learn, you know, not just Japanese or Chinese, but the Chinese characters. How, if you don't have a Chinese character background in your first language, how do you acquire them? Is there an easier way to do it? And I thought I'd like to go back to school and get a PhD and be able to teach Japanese and Chinese at the college level. And I knew I'd have to have a PhD, but I don't want to abandon ESL. I want to keep, you know, teaching something related to ESL. And so that's what motivated me. And I started looking at different PhDs, and I realized what I wanted was a PhD in second language acquisition. And so there's only a handful of schools in the US that offer a PhD in that. And I applied to all of them, and I got rejected by the University of Hawaii. And and I was like, come on, man. But no hard feelings. But and then I was tentatively accepted to all others, but in the end, only three offered funding. And that was the University of Maryland, University of South Florida, and Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh. And I chose Carnegie Mellon more than anything because that was the one school of the three where I was guaranteed a teaching position to teach Japanese and to do research with Japanese and Chinese characters.
I love Carnegie Mellon. I love the philosophy.
Yeah, it was a great experience. It was a grueling experience, but it was a great experience. So I went to Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh, and like so many other places I'd never been, I just chose it and I went there, and I lived in Pittsburgh for about 5 years. Another great experience. So that's how I ended up back in the US, and I went to Carnegie Mellon. And so my PhD is in second language acquisition. And because of the nature of my research, I focused on reading and writing systems. So my background was very reading focused. So a lot of theory and, you know, the underpinnings behind a lot of, you know, teaching techniques, methodologies, whatever, they get pulled in from, you know, not one specific language, but across different languages, and you can apply it to, you know, whatever language, you know, you're teaching. And I'm oversimplifying, but, so I knew that that would give me the background I needed to, you know, if I wanted to continue in the three languages that I hoped to work on. And so that also positioned me as a reading specialist. So that's kind of how I got my job at Valley College. So I was actually originally looking for, I was thinking to work in ESL, or Japanese, or do both. And I taught Japanese actually, at the University of Virginia for a while after, you know, I was still in my PhD program, but I moved to Charlottesville, because my wife, she got her PhD from the University of Virginia. So we met in Pittsburgh, and we got married by some people's standards rather quickly. I don't think so, but, you know, eight years this year, and, for the naysayers, but, no, I love my wife and, a lot. And, it's, you know, I'm very thankful for her because we both met mid PhD, and she's also a first generation college student, a working class kid. And, you know, she teaches at Cal State Long Beach. She's a linguistic anthropologist. And, when we talk to students, we often think, I wish someone would have told me this because this would have made my life easier as a student. And so I think that we both kind of approach teaching from that perspective. But, anyway, I taught Japanese at UVA, and, then the work dried up and I needed to look for a job. And so she thought she was going to get work. And if you're in Charlottesville and you're in academia, you either work at UVA or you're broke. And so I started looking for work down the road. I went to Lynchburg College an hour away, Richmond, Virginia, looked at DC, nothing. I was like, well, our original plan was we'd stay in Virginia until she finished her PhD. Then we'd both look for work. You know, life is like, ha, 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 it's not going to happen. So I applied all over the country, and I saw there were lots of jobs in California. I probably applied to like 30 community college jobs, didn't get one call back. And not Valley College though. There was nothing available at that time. And you know, I was applying for anything I was qualified for that was related to what I enjoyed, like, you know, teaching English as a second language, you know, English even a reading position. And I ended up getting a job at UCLA, UCLA Extension, where I was an ESL program coordinator. And I did that for a couple of years. And so I was, it was an administrative position. So I supervised other instructors, ESL instructors, you know, I designed curricula, things like that. But I, you know, and I told the hiring manager at the time, the director, he was a great guy. And I said, I'll be honest with you, you know, I really like to teach. And he's like, no, just do this for a couple of years and get some experience, you know, and, you know, if you want to still teach, you should go on and do that. And he was always very supportive. And so I did that. I started looking for teaching jobs, and, I applied for my current position, and I got a call back, and, you know, the rest, as they say, is history. So I'm actually officially in the psychology department, and the courses I teach are developmental communications courses, which are reading and study skills courses. And so I do that because, like I said, I, by the virtue of my PhD coursework and research, I'm a reading specialist, but I'm also able to teach in the credit ESL department at Valley College. So I get to do, again, lots of things that I enjoy doing. So I'm very thankful.
Yeah, I remember there had been a decades-long battle to have a reading specialist. There seemed to be a fight between English and DevCom reading, where the DevCom people were saying they're not the same thing. And now, as a math person in all these meetings, I never really understood it. Like, I don't understand the difference between the two. But now that you've explained your background and your history, I'm just humbled by what it takes to be a reading specialist, like what that entails, like what you're trying to do, who you're trying to impact, how you have to take people from many different languages, because your starting point with each person is in a different place. I'm just sort of humbled by sort of the sheer complexity of the job that you have.
Well, I think one of the, so the classes I teach, the developmental communications classes that I teach, they're open to any students at Valley College who want to take them. So what that means is I often work with students with very, as you said, very different backgrounds. Many of my students, I mean, all kinds of backgrounds. So it's one of the biggest challenges is trying to figure out how to meet the course objectives, you know, the student learning outcomes, while making the class accessible to students at the lower end or with less experience. Especially, I work with a lot of students whose first language is not English. Brilliant, hardworking people, but they're still on their learning curve with English. So make the class accessible to students like that, while also working with students who might be, for example, returning to college later in life, and English is their first language, and they're actually, they're very accomplished readers, but they need a little more practice, you know, help with like study skills and how to focus what they already know and apply that to a college format. So that is probably the biggest challenge. Now in the ESL classes that I teach, there are different levels. So like if I teach a reading class in credit ESL, those students are of a closer range of skills and proficiency. And so it's, those courses are easier in that respect. There are other challenges, but that's not one of them.
Wow. I think John's description of humbled certainly fits me too. You have an incredible story, Eric. The experiences that you had, the education that you have behind you, and all of that that you bring to Valley College and at Valley, you know, working across two different areas, helping students. I'm lucky my office is down the hallway from Eric, so we get to see each other here and there and have sat in committee meetings together. And it's been a real pleasure to sit down though and to dig into the real story and really see, you know, how it was that you made it to Valley College. I just want to say thank you so much for sitting down and sharing everything with us today, Eric. Much appreciated.
It's my pleasure. And Scott, I should thank you as well, because your office is down the hall from my office. I know that I went into your office many times and said, I have a question about Valley College. What should I do? And you were always, and no matter how busy you were always there to lend an ear or to help me out and point me in the right direction. And I do appreciate that. And I've worked with so many great people at Valley. You know, John and I have been on different committees together, and he's been around longer than I have, and I've learned a lot from working with, you know, people like both of you, you know, who've had more experience, and I really do appreciate that.
Well, thanks so much for sharing your story. It's really amazing. I mean, when we started picking at it, I didn't know where it was going to go, and it's really exciting to see where you've been, and I'm sure this adventure you're on is going to continue. I don't think someone like you stops having an adventure in life, you know?
Eric, what's the best way for students or faculty or someone to get a hold of you? You know, if they want to follow up, is it, you know, visit the website, send you an email, stop by your office? What would you prefer?
Email is always good. You know, the last name Maseko is not very common, so it's easy to find me. Just type Eric Maseko, and it will be me or some other person in Arizona. And I'm not the person in Arizona. And here in Los Angeles, to my knowledge, there are three. I mean, in Los Angeles County, you know, Greater Los LA area, there are only three Dr. Masekos. There's a dermatologist, and then there's me and my wife. So just type Dr. Maseko, and you probably find us. So there's no hiding. Yeah.
Perfect, man. Thank you so much, Eric.
Thank you. It's been a great conversation. Thanks, guys.